What are the best ways to stimulate collagen in the skin?
It is common knowledge that healthy skin is rich in the protein called collagen. It's generally well understood that collagen in the skin progressively diminishes with age. This, of course, has created a lot of opportunity for businesses to sell products and procedures to restore collagen in your skin. The marketing of creams, supplements, and devices has created many misconceptions about collagen. I'll discuss some basic principles about collagen and how I help my patients with their skin in my practice. I'm Dr. Amiya Prasad. I'm a board-certified cosmetic surgeon and fellowship-trained oculofacial, plastic, and reconstructive surgeon. I've been in practice in Manhattan and Long Island for over 20 years. Facial skin rejuvenation has been an important part of my practice throughout my career. In fact, one of the first injectable products I used was Xyderm and Xyplast, which was referred to at the time as collagen injections. It is routine for me to perform rejuvenation procedures such as facelifts, eyelid surgery, and implant placement. Whether it's part of a surgical rejuvenation or an office procedure, I routinely perform various treatments to stimulate collagen, including the use of lasers, radiofrequency technology, microneedling, skin boosting, and platelet-rich plasma, or PRP. So where does collagen actually exist in the skin? Most people I see in my practice are familiar with the layers of the skin called the epidermis and the dermis. On the face, the skin is about 2 millimeters in thickness, with the eyelid skin being only about 0.5 millimeter in thickness. The dermis is the deeper layer and is the foundation of the skin. You can think of collagen as cables of protein which support the skin's foundation. As mentioned earlier, a natural cause of progressive loss of collagen is aging. It is generally accepted rule of thumb in the medical community that you lose about 1% of your collagen in your skin every year after the age of 20. There are other factors which can further decrease the collagen in your skin. These include smoking, excess sun exposure, indoor tanning, and many medical conditions, particularly those associated with systemic inflammation, nutritional deficiencies, and environmental toxins. The take-home message is to first focus on ways you can prevent the acceleration of collagen loss as well. Understanding that collagen is a protein which is made inside the body should be a guiding principle to address two common things people do, which is not very productive. The first is the application of creams, which are often very expensive and which claim to contain and thus deliver collagen to your skin. These creams may be decent moisturizers, but they cannot deliver collagen into the dermis. Fine lines may appear to improve instantly after application with the use of these creams due to the moisturizers and concealers in the product. Most over-the-counter creams are cosmetics, not pharmaceuticals. They are sold with slick marketing and attractive packaging. Put these same products in no-frills containers and all you have are generic moisturizers. A similar concept is the sale of collagen capsules as supplements. The claim is that by ingesting collagen in capsule or pill form, the collagen will find its way to your skin. As mentioned earlier, collagen is a protein. A protein is made up of amino acids. As is the case with any protein you eat, your digestive system breaks down the protein into amino acids. Therefore, there is no advantage in taking collagen capsules over any other protein source with comparable amino acid composition. It is a common belief is that facial aging is limited to the skin. This belief has been reinforced by decades of cosmetics advertising. It's not the case. The most significant effect of facial aging is found at the bone structure level. This has been well established in the medical literature. This volume loss contributes significantly to the appearance of your skin. With this understanding, I approach facial rejuvenation from the inside out. For example, I routinely perform a procedure where I place long-lasting hyaluronic acid fillers at the bone level. This is essentially using the principles of facial implant surgery to the placement of fillers. We refer to this as structural volumizing. When volume is restored, the skin looks better and the facial balance is restored. Youthful skin is characterized by even color, smooth texture, and luster. Once again, thinking about skin from the inside out, it's important to understand that the soft and youthful appearance of younger skin is not just a function of the epidermis and dermis, but also the layer of fat and blood supply under the skin called the subdermis. A healthy subdermis is critical for healthy skin. It is a common perception that skin is simply a covering for your body, when actually your skin is a structure with nerves and blood supply. It's a living organ. This means that your general health and your lifestyle has a direct effect on your skin the same way as it would on your heart and your lungs. Simply, your skin benefits from stress management, exercise, healthy diet, and avoidance of cigarette smoking and excess sun exposure. In my practice, I help my patients with the subdermis using PRP or platelet-rich plasma. PRP or platelet-rich plasma is a concentration of the wound healing and growth factors in your blood which are recruited for injury repair, such as when you get a cut. This results in an improvement of the blood supply to the skin as well as the quality of the fat cells that are directly below the dermis. When you look at someone who's young, the skin has a soft and lustrous quality, which is often referred to as baby fat. With this understood, it makes sense to strategically use PRP to enhance the quality of your skin from the subdermis level. The level of the epidermis and dermis, which is in total about 2 millimeters in thickness, or essentially what we all see from the outside, is where the cosmetics industry, the injectable manufacturers, the lasers and related technology industries, and of course, the professional medical retailers are all claiming to have the ultimate solution for this 2 millimeter thick structure. This is where the collagen induction strategies are all focused. Whether it's microneedling, dermabrasion, laser, ultrasound, or radio frequency, the goal of any given procedure is to induce your skin to produce collagen. This is based on the skin's ability to produce collagen as a response to an injury. I've observed from seeing patients who've had one very aggressive treatment, such as an ultrasound which heats the skin to a very high temperature, described often as very painful, that the patient's skin actually looks thin. These same patients feel that they look older after this treatment. The same description is applicable for people who've had multiple different lasers done by multiple different practitioners. When each technology creates an injury to the skin to stimulate collagen production, does anyone ask the question, is there capacity for the skin to respond effectively to this treatment? It looks like that question doesn't get asked, and there's more of a hope and see what happens attitude. In states like New York, where I practice, there is no law requiring only licensed professionals like doctors to perform these types of procedures. This has resulted in many non-physicians being either delegated or working independently without the benefit of an experienced MD overseeing directly on-site the patient's treatment. So how do I help my patients who want more collagen in their skin in my practice? I perform a thorough history and physical examination, as well as take high-resolution digital photos, including using techniques such as backlighting for people who have acne scars. Since a lot of devices are being marketed and claimed to induce collagen to a level where the face is lifted without surgery, I provide my patients with a full understanding of my inside-to-outside approach. This means understanding bone volume loss, loss of fat and volume in the subdermis, and the specific characteristics of the dermis and the epidermis. When it comes to the skin being only 2 millimeters in thickness and the health of the subdermis being very important, I look to create a treatment plan which looks at the long-term effects and benefits. In order to have a successful strategy, there are some key elements to treatments which every patient I see needs. Number one, there should be minimal discomfort. Number two, there should be minimal or no downtime. Number three, there should be a highly predictable outcome. In terms of the devices which improve skin quality through collagen induction and remodeling, I use a radiofrequency technology as well as a long-pulsed ND-YAG laser technology. These devices do apply progressive temperature elevation to induce collagen production and remodeling, resulting in skin tightening and, when desired, fat reduction. Both of these technologies are well tolerated and patients come back for additional treatment without hesitation. The dermis is the level of the skin which provides a foundation for the epidermis. When this foundation is weakened, lines and wrinkles form. I routinely use non-ablative laser technology where the collagen remodeling is induced without removing or creating holes in the top layer of the skin. In addition, I use this technology to treat discolorations which are often associated with the fine lines and loss of collagen caused by excessive sun exposure. There's usually no downtime and I'm able to help my patients improve the skin thickness and color. We refer to this as laser skin toning. In the spirit of avoiding overheating or over-traumatizing the skin to induce more collagen, I developed a process where I use microchannel technology to deliver PRP and hyaluronic acid directly to the dermis without any bleeding or bruising, which we call skin boosting. I'm inducing significant collagen production and improving skin quality with better circulation without causing any injury to the skin. In areas of the skin, such as the eyelids, I often use laser technologies such as long-pulsed erbium laser and fractional CO2 laser. Throughout my career, I've observed a trend where industry first influenced doctors' purchasing of devices such as lasers by hiring so-called thought leaders in dermatology to peddle their lasers. In the past several years, they've taken it to a new level where they create brands of devices and market aggressively directly to consumers to create pressure on doctors to buy or lease these devices. This creates more of a business transaction-focused attitude towards people who seek to have these latest and greatest procedures. Paid celebrities further create even more hype. I see this as a hijacking of the judgment of a physician for profit and effectively forcing practitioners to feel obligated to get these devices, who then push their patients through treatments to meet their financial obligations. I look at these things in a simple way. If a laser or a device is going to be useful, I don't lease it. I buy it outright. I look at the technology as a tool which I use when it's appropriate, not because it's literally the hot treatment of the week. For the medispa or any practice where surgery or other options are not available, and that hot treatment of the week is now a monthly expense, well, you know what the best option for anyone who walks in will be. As a surgeon focused on facial aging solutions, I provide my patients with a comprehensive approach without any bias. I look at achieving healthy skin the way I look at muscle building. Apply safe and predictable approaches and always think long term. I hope you found this information helpful. Thank you for your question.